So we're going to get the mic going around for you guys. I'm sure you have a lot to ask Stephen, so I'm just going to sort of set us up here. So I'm curious, you know, the film sort of puts out that, you know, the impetus for documenting Jay at this time was the move, but I'm curious if you thought about whether you yourself or, gee, you know, somebody should do a movie about Jay way sooner than the move.
Oh, well, you know, he's just such an incredible character, you know, beyond his artistic sensibilities, obviously. And what I think the reason this whole thing happened was because for probably over 20 years, I know him, you know, almost 42 years. So for probably within the first 10 years of knowing Jay, I used to tease him and I'd say, you know, Jay, if you ever move, I'm definitely going to film this move because this is going to be the mother of all moves. And he used to go, yeah, man, yeah, yeah, but never thinking that he would ever move because extracting him out of that building, I just didn't think it was possible, you know. And then at 84 years old, he called me and he goes, hey, man, and I could just hear it in his voice, I got to sell. I go, what are you talking about? He says, I got to move. I can't afford to keep it anymore. And so that... that moment was very real to me. You know, one of the things about the film for me is, as an artist and a photographer for decades now, there's a whole different attitude right now in terms of the idea of an apprenticeship and how you learn. And so in a lot of ways, I never had anybody yet I could really pass the torch to yet as a mentor. And I felt when Jay told me he was going to give it up, I felt like this was an opportunity for me to tell his life story through the building and in a way get to share with you, the audience, everything he taught me. So it was just one of those kind of moments that happened, and you know, and that's where things happen. You know, there's this intersection and you just go with your gut, and I knew I had to do it. I just had no idea how it was going to all end up, but
yeah,
I did it.
Yeah. I heard an interview with you guys. I think it was you guys were doing a video for B&H, I think, mm-hmm. And he was talking about how, you know, his attitude was, you know, do this if you want to. He didn't really see much of a story there.
Right. He's always saying, he goes, I don't see this as a story, man. I mean, I'm not that interesting, okay, man. He always says, you know, you can't smell yourself, man. And I look at him and I always say to him, I go, you know, Jay, you may not be able to smell yourself, but I can smell you, and I'm telling you, you're really interesting. So he didn't, you know, he can't smell himself, and as a result, I don't think he ever really sort of, and he's also a very private person, you know, in a very deep regard. He, you know, he lived very much, you know, in a closed, you know, in that incredible space, but nobody knew who lived there. In fact, he purposely was so paranoid about somebody coming in, breaking in, robbing him, that he kept the building looking like it was vacant almost from the outside. And then he had to seal all the windows eventually because he couldn't afford to replace them. So there were all these levels of things that would happen that would sort of add to the mystique of the building. But paramount to that was he was a really private person. And so for me, you know, to get to know him the way I did and this kind of friendship, and he was such an important element in my life and person in my life, I really... the idea of it disappearing just was almost unimaginable to me. So, you know, I just felt like I can't tell you how many people I believe have been affected by the bank physically when you walk into it. There was something about it that was quite magical, that your visual cortex would be hit and you just come out and you'd be like, oh my God, I'm seeing something else. And he would take lots of time to, I think, reward you for curiosity. So every level, like I described in the film, was like a set cross-section of his mind. I think as you got into each floor and got into each level, the deeper you would look, the more he would reward you with the idea of someone who was not just looking but was seeing.
It's super interesting. I mean, you're saying, you know, he can't smell himself. You know, I think we're really privileged to get even just the littlest whiff, you know, here in this film. But it's so interesting because, you know, when I saw this for the first time, you know, I didn't know anything about Jay, mm-hmm. But I knew the building just in walking by. And my first reaction was, oh, that place. Oh, okay, now I'm going to get the story of this building that I've walked by 100 times. And I think one of the things that I sort of pulled out of this was Jay's story is also very much, you know, the story of New York right now. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, your New York was different than Jay's, and mine is different than yours, you know, coming up in the city and stuff. And I'm curious if any of that was, you know, going through your head, the parallels here.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I was down, when I started working for Jay, it was 1979, and it was the most amazing time in the Bowery. I used to see Jean-Michel Basquiat literally doing Samo writings on the building. I would see Keith Haring drawing Barking Dog on the sidewalk in chalk, and Jay used to say to me, if you see that guy doing the Barking Dog thing, tell him to use paint. I really like those drawings. You know? And so it was just an amazing time. I used to go, I would commute from Long Island, I'd get in at 8 o'clock in the morning. I'd go for a quick coffee on Spring Street. Louise Nevelson would sit in the same coffee shop every morning, and she would have, you know, an espresso by herself, and she'd have this, like, turban on her head, and, you know, her aura was just incredible, and I knew she must have been a big artist. I really didn't learn until later just what an incredible artist she was. But it was a magical time to be in the Bowery and to be part of that sort of scene, CBGBs and everything. But make no mistake, after hours, it was very, very challenging and spooky and crazy, and you didn't want to hang around a lot outside. And you were very thankful that the payphone on the corner worked. Let's put it that way. There were no cell phones, right? So.
You got a mic going around? Here, we got a question already in the back.
Yes. Completely aside from Jay, I'm interested in how this experience of watching this older man who was your mentor, your teacher, your friend, as an artist yourself, how did this experience of moving, aging, divesting, how did it change you?
That's a great question. It did change me in a lot of ways. I think one of the, you know, this film is a love letter to Jay. It's a love letter to photography. It's a love letter to New York. And for me, what I realized, I think a lot of my motivation was, as a friend, I wanted to comfort him through the process. So physically being there, as much as he'll kid and say how, you know, challenging I was, like I was Katsu or whatever. He describes me as a toothache that wouldn't go away. I think I made it much less painful for him in a way. And I think, to your question, that I think when we all, as human beings, go through difficult moments like this in our lives, and we all have to go through them, whether it's our parents or eventually ourselves, having family, having friends, being able, there's a wonderful saying that somebody told me. They said, sharing good news with a friend is twice as good, and when you share bad news with a friend, it makes it half as bad. And that's kind of what I learned from this experience.
Because he was so, you know, not really a public-facing guy like that, do you think he would have let someone not in his circle make this film?
He would have never let anybody do this. He had been approached by, you know, people for years wanting to come in, and, you know, I think, you know, we have a friendship and a certain kind of chemistry together, and he trusted me, and I think he knew that underneath it all, he knew what I was really after, and, you know, like he said, he couldn't smell himself, but I think he recognized that what he had, what he created in that building, and what, you know, he's created over his lifetime has really great value. And one of the things for me about Jay that's special that I try to share in the film is these are life lessons that Jay speaks about. You know, I share a lot of the wisdom he's imparted on me with my own children, and it's affected their lives and their careers. So part of, I think, why maybe this film resonates with many people is that it's, you don't have to be a photographer. There, you know, his lessons are sort of universal to just living, in a way.
Where are we? Yeah.
Stephen, thank you for making this documentary of an iconic figure.
Thank you.
I was very fortunate to study with Jay for 1 week in 2009. And he not only was a fantastic photographer and artist and human being, but he cared. And that week was seeing, looking, but caring. When he walked out in that street and he saw people, he cared about them. And that's something that I will always remember. And sitting here and watching this is real. This is how he lived. And this is how his friends respected him. And I thank you in gratitude for making this.
Thank you so much.
Well, this is the second time I saw the film, Stephen.
How great.
I spoke to you yes. down at the film forum. But I also took a few workshops with Jay, and I used to watch him around Dean and DeLuca shooting. And we talked many times. And I love the film.
Thank you.
And I wanted to find out, when did you leave as working for him and start filming? When did you stop still photography?
Well, I haven't stopped still photography. I mean, I really did this project. I was in the middle of creating I've been doing a series for 10 years called Day to Night. And I was, quite frankly, finishing my book when all this, you know, started happening, and I just dropped everything. I just sort of said, I'm committing 6 months. My wife thought, you know, what are you doing? And, you know, she's like, what? And I'm like, I got to shoot this, you know, and I just, I was blessed. I had my assistant, Christiana, who's worked with me, and I had a great young cinematographer who did all the Steadicam work, Jason Green. I had a fantastic young little crew, very, very small. Jay will go, oh, you guys, you came in with 15 guys. Hey, no, Jay, we had 3 people, and we would basically walk in. He goes, well, all those names on the end credits. I go, well, Jay, that's how you end up making a movie, you know. But the truth is, you know, it was kind of by the seat of my pants. I'd never really done anything like this. For a very short time in my career in the 80s, I was a commercial, or early 90s, a commercial director. But I hated it because I just, you know, it was like all these people making decisions, and it was like I couldn't go to the bathroom without making a decision. And so I just said, you know, I want to go back to my camera. But I've been watching documentary over the last 5 years, and I think that was part of the intersection where the idea came from. And I started getting excited about the storytelling that was going on in the documentary space. And then Jay told me he's moving, and that was it. Boom. I just knew that was the film I had to tell, in the story I had to tell. Yeah.
So during the process of making this, you know, coming from the photography world, what did you find sort of challenging about, you know, working in a different, but not entirely foreign medium?
Well, you know, I say to people, I'm really a storyteller. I really, you know, that's something I, especially with my work I've been doing the last 10 years, Day to Night, where I'm compressing time in a photograph, I create narratives within my photographs. So this idea of, and I'm doing it into a photograph itself, right? So when I got into this, doing the film, I started to think about, you know, the idea of, the vehicle of the move really was the gift, because through the move, I could take you through this whole experience and share with you. Obviously, it creates a tension in the film because, you know he has to get out of there within a certain time. And he says to me, he goes, yeah, there's no tension, there's no this. You know, like he didn't understand what I was going to do. I said, Jay, there's tension. You had to get out of there because otherwise the sale doesn't go through. So, it was, like I said, I had a great group, great writer that we brought in, Josh Alexander, who helped me shape the story. Armando Crota was an editor. Another one named Daniel Harworth, who's a terrific comedic editor, and he really helped with a lot of the speed and the timing on the back end. And Doug Blush, who was the supervising editor, is a genius. You know, so a lot of great people helped me.
I have a 2-part question.
Oh, one. Sorry.
We'll get you.
Promise.
Yes. Microphone first.
One is, do you know what the disposition of the building is now? If it's going to be raised completely, if they're going to
preserve it's a landmark building, so you can't raise it. You can't do anything except what it's land. Once it's landmark status, everything has to be done exactly as it was. You can't do any kind of radical, you know, changes to the building.
But and you the can guy, still he, do a high rise behind.
No. This building, Abby Rosen bought the building, and I have to say he did a beautiful restoration job. The only loss was that last room that you see. Jay goes, "This is my favorite room. Did you shoot that ceiling? That room is gone." So they put in a second elevator, and they took out the president's office. So that room doesn't exist anymore, unfortunately.
But otherwise, the building
otherwise, the building is, they literally restored every single window to exactly the way it was, to the moldings, the original doors they restored. It's an incredible restoration. And all the eccentric things Jay did, like the gigantic plastic tube that would air condition the space, you saw that in the beginning of the film, yeah. Looked like a giant condom. That actually is now done sort of the right way. But so they took a lot of Jay's sort of engineering kind of visual things that he did and made them, you know, concrete and, you know, modernized it. So it's quite interesting.
Using it as a residence?
No, it's actually, believe it or not, my old agent, they're in the building now. Great Bowery has taken over the space, five floors. So it's kind of surreal that actually I had access to the building right after it was sold, because my agent was now basically had five floors in the building. It was completely nuts that of all the tenants they would get, that would be the tenant. You know?
Yeah, really. Where are we? Yes, over here.
Yeah, I arrived in New York City, Thanksgiving, 1979, Chinatown, accidentally, yeah. Because I thought I was trying to go to Midtown, and it was in Chinatown. So anyway, the one thing that stood out for me as a photographer also is he said about the editing, mm-hmm. 1 hour shooting and 1 day editing. So he didn't elaborate anymore, but since you work with him, I would like to have a little touch of that observation with him.
In terms of the editing?
Right. One hour shooting and one
day.
Oh,
yeah. So editing, you know, one of the things Jay's doing right now, people always ask, is he out still shooting? He's actually editing 60 years of photographs right now, every day. If you go to his website, jmazel.com, you'll see every 2 weeks he posts another boatload of images. You know, he's got this whole system where he takes his old Kodachromes and he photographs them on a light box so he can digitize them instantly. And they're doing it thousands upon thousands of. So he's rediscovering. He's traveling around the world through his images again. You know, because it's become difficult. He has some, you know, arthritic conditions that really make it difficult for him to stand prolonged periods, and he just can't carry a camera and balance a cane at the same time. He shoots with an iPhone occasionally, but the editing has become his real life force right now, and he's editing is everything. And I'll tell you, someone asked earlier, what did I learn about the film, you know, through this process, is I now look at my own archive and realize how much work I need to do. And so I'm, you know, I'm 61 now, but you know, it's you don't want to wait till you're 80 to start diving deep. I you know, that's one thing I've learned. And the other thing is I need to have a death cleaning soon because Jay did infect me to a certain degree with collecting, although, you know, I don't have, you know, a 6-floor, 72-room bank. But
is this for some kind of a book prep or just going through for posterity's sake? Or is there a goal with the...
For me...
With Jay.
Jay's really funny because I keep saying to them, I go, Jay, you got like how many, 50 books in there at least, maybe more? And he goes, I don't want to do that, man. I'll let someone else deal with that stuff afterwards. He goes back and forth. He doesn't want the aggravation to have anybody to deal with. And I keep explaining to him, trying to explain to him that he doesn't need anybody anymore. Like he can actually do the distributor. He can hire the best designers in the world. Everything can be exactly the way Jay wants it. But I don't think he just wants to focus on the editing, get his collection to where he wants it, where his hands on it. He decides every image he likes, and that's where he's at right now. So I don't know, you know, he may change his mind. He may say, yeah, I'm going to do 20 books. But right now it's just editing, yeah.
Where's our mic?
This lady right here.
Came back here. Oh, there we go, microphone.
I love the film.
Thank you so much.
And it occurred to me with the juxtaposition of the incredible hoarding job that he did.
By the way, he does not like the word hoarding. He says hoarders do not show their wares to people. He's a collector, and therefore he shows you everything. So if he was here, he'd be like, I'm not a hoarder, man. You know.
Didn't see any like flattened cats in the building.
Yeah, right.
only mattresses. So, I appreciate the correction, but
no worries.
Occurred to me was that in a way, every time you're capturing a photograph, it's sort of like hoarding a moment in time that you don't want to let go of.
That's very
because
true.
Because of the way that you juxtaposed him as the collector and also the each moment being this crystallized experience and those pauses when he would take his walks out there. And
no, you made it. That's a very accurate parallel. I wouldn't, and I don't know if I'd use the word hoarder. He's a, you know, he is so drawn to anything that he finds beauty in.
Right.
And that's what he's collecting.
Right.
You know, and it's these, whether they're an, it's an object, a moment in time, yeah. All that stuff is like, yeah, it's the same. It's on a certain frequency for him.
And it seemed to me that when he captures the image, that and I realized that what we see is what he's already decided he wants to share, and that there may be many others, but that each capture is this moment that he's in some way hanging on to. And so you've got, as you were talking about time, I was thinking about, it's kind of like hoarding time or collecting moments of time, but mm-hmm. but that you've got this compression of time into the photo, but this moment where time stops. So
oh, in the bank,
got
yeah.
A
yeah.
lot of the playing around with the fourth dimension, and I was curious. They don't want me anymore. Oh, back on. Anyway, I was curious about that as a motivation in the eyes of a photographer to just hold that moment, because I feel on an amateur level, I feel myself wanting to do that. And so I was curious if that's something that you feel he had either inspired in you, or how you see yourself on a spectrum that's maybe not as, you don't have as many places as the bank, but how do you live that?
Well, the bank, I mean, Jay really inspired me, particularly in color. Okay, if you look at my work now, like I do this, I change time in a photograph, but I change the color of light over time. And so I'm doing things in color that's, you know, based on clearly what Albers was sharing with Jay, but I'm exploring a whole new way of seeing it in a photograph. And that comes, the root of that is from my experience with Jay. The interesting thing in this film is that when Jay is looking at those hands, and I found that footage, and I heard him say he's really curious about trying to capture the passage of time. It's like an impossible thing to... I went like, are you kidding me? Like, that's my whole... That's my life's work now has been that idea, that concept. And we never, ever spoke about that before. So that was kind of an incredible moment. But I think, you know, in the end, I think what Jay did for me was just define the work ethic. And I think it was I found somebody in him who got as excited as I did at just looking at things. And I think the reason we really connect and the reason we have this relationship is because we both have this almost childlike joy in when we see. And so when you have that in somebody, even though there was this, you know, 25 year whatever age difference, we were just, it was like I was we were playmates. You know, there's this story, honestly, if we ever got in a car together, it was like Taggart's dual steering wheel, because both of us would be looking and somebody needed to drive, you know, so it was always something challenging.
Where's our microphone?
Yeah. Up here. It was a really wonderful film, and it seemed to operate on so many different levels. So there was the level of the brilliant photographer and photography, and I'm also an amateur photographer, and I was just like totally mesmerized by his work. And then there was a kind of biography of him, and then there was the biography of New York. And I almost feel like there could be a separate film. I'm also going back to the kind of hoarding, collecting, because I'm a therapist, and I've worked with people who were hoarder collectors, that whole thing, you couldn't possibly do the real time, but it must, just looking at everything, it must have been so incredible, the work that was needed to divest that space of all his stuff.
It's letting go, right? I mean, it's the thing we all have to go through, and, you know, we all experience it, and you know, like I said, I knew it was gonna. I'll be honest. I actually, about halfway through the filming, I thought, oh my God, it might kill him. I thought the letting go of the bank, if you notice the film gets darker because we're going into winter as the movie really starts. And the other thing you'll notice is that Jay gets actually physically sick through the process. And I equated it to when you watch, you know, E.T., Elliot and E.T. When E.T. gets sick, Elliot is sick. They're connected. Jay is the bank and occupied the bank in a way that it was almost beyond, an emotional connection to it, a very deep symbiosis, yeah. And so my big fear was the stress of him detaching and basically deconstructing his life in that building was gonna be just too much for him at his age. But as everything he has done throughout his life and as 42 years that I know him, just when you think you have him figured out, he's back. And he called me about 3 months ago, and he, for the most part, he's been somewhat depressed, as you might imagine, from even though he has like all this money and whatever, but he doesn't have his bank. And he has this high-pitched quality in his voice, and he sounds really happy, and he goes, I go, what's going on? He goes, I got a space, man. I go, what do you mean? He goes, 2 doors away, I'm taking over a parking garage. I go, you are? He goes, yeah, repouring the floors, and I'm bringing 11 truckloads back. I go, listen, you gotta let me film this. I said, this could be like the sequel, I'm back. He goes, F you, man, you're not coming in here. This is my private thing, you can't come in here. I'm sorry, no way, no effing way. So. So the photos, that was something I spent an enormous amount of time and energy, and I really saw that as, I wanted his words and his images to really drive together, like to really touch you in a way, in terms of not only what emotionally you were gonna look at, but when he talks about color and his concept of color and how what color theory is, I wanted those images to match that. When you saw the bank view, you know, I mean, listen, I called him when 9/11 happened. He wasn't even looking out the window. I called him at 8:55 after the first plane struck, and I said, Jay, are you? He goes, hey, man, what's going on? I was like, so that was a part of the story, but I was very sensitive to that, even how, because you bring 9/11 into anything, and it changes the whole tone of whatever you're going to do. But it was important for me to be able to do that. So as far as the images, it was very, very much, I wanted it to really speak beyond, you know, I wanted to really reinforce his words with his images. That was really, really important to me.
I do just want to say you did handle the 9/11 photos the way that that should have been handled, yeah, for sure. Yeah. Where's our microphone? Yeah, in the back.
Hi, I just wanted to put another spin on it, which resonated for me, which is the word curator. Mm-hmm. In a sense, for me, the bank, for him, perhaps, was this amazing museum with a permanent collection.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And there was a sense for me that he was delighted to show you and to curate. He's curating as he photographs, and also when he shows, look at this, and look closely, the concept of close looking.
Mm-hmm. So. He would do, you know, what's so interesting, that's you're 100% right. He did curate it. And what he would do is he would, from afar, he loves multiplicity. So he loves to create pattern out of single objects, right? And by having 10 or 15 or 20, it creates something else. Then you get closer to it, it creates something else, right? There are all these things. He's always working on levels in terms of the way your brain sees things, and then he wants to bring you in and get closer and closer and closer. There's more to discover, more to reward if you take the time to look, right? And so when I would get into the bank, when I go on the fifth floor, inevitably there'd be something. One of my favorite little stories was I was walking around, you know, and I just explore. I would always be curious, and he knew that. And so I was by myself on the fifth floor one day, and I see this old, tattered book. It's like this falling apart, looks like something out of a Harry Potter movie. and it looks like if you blow on it, it'll just go poof and disappear. But I was so curious about it because it was this tattered old leather book, and I was like, wonder what is in that book? Why does he have that book? And I go over to it, and I begin to undo the leather strap that's on it, and I peel the cover back ever so delicately, and it doesn't disintegrate. And on the front page, Jay was a calligrapher also, among his other talents. And in calligraphy, he writes, never judge a book by its cover. I mean, you see what I'm saying? He was setting it up. He knew I was going to get there. Somebody was going to get there who was curious. He had to feed, you know, he's going to reward me. Okay, and he rewarded me with that great funny line, as only Jay can do it. So.
I want to get a couple more in here.
What you just said leads into my first comment. It's a wonderful film, and I think it reflects the relationship between you and Jay. And my question is, you've been in touch with him recently, and he's very immersed in editing his work. Mm-hmm. And does he see a connection between screening the film and what he's doing in terms of editing? Has he expressed an interest in?
You know, he's so funny because he's like, I don't know, man. I'm not really comfortable like being famous or something. The funniest thing is he's actually seen it now like about six times, and he goes, I got to be honest. Every time I see it, I hear something better. He loves the film. He really loves the film. Although he still can't believe that I actually have a story. That's the thing. He still can't get over that there's actually a story about him. You know, so he's like you said, he's always going like this, trying to smell himself, but he can't smell himself. So, but yeah, I mean, it's. I think he's very moved by it. You know, he. He's a man of very quiet emotions. He doesn't show a lot. I think in the film, that scene where he looks out the window and he's pointing and he's teaching me, right, to look. He's teaching all of us, look at that, look at that, look at that. But there's that one moment, and that's the only time, you know, you could actually see it in his eyes, what he was about to let go of. And so.
It's funny, I was going to ask you, but I think it's like the most powerful part of the film is just watching him. You can see his mind working.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It's amazing.
It's the joy of the act of photographing.
Yeah. Okay, here.
Thank you so much for this film. There were so many, you mentioned his words.
I'm so blinded by the light. Okay. I just wanted to see you. Yeah.
So you mentioned his words his words and the pictures. Mm-hmm. So I just wonder, because for me, there were so many great quotes in the movie. Have you ever like just watched the movie and picked out quotes from yourself that could go with images? Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah, sure. I mean, you know, these are things. Jay is a quote machine. You know, he's having a conversation and he just boom just goes off. And one of the challenges with Jay, this is a really funny story. So, you know, in the beginning of the film, he says, you know, man, he says to me, this is the first day I'm interviewing him. And I said, you know, I really want to go deeper, Jay. You know, I'm sort of describing what I want to do in the film. And he looks at me, he goes, you know, Stephen, you're only as intelligent as the person interviewing you. Well, that was like, that line just, you know, that's my first day on the job. I mean, I'm thinking, oh, this is going to be just great. I mean, I may have to go back for therapy after this. And I leave it, and I just was able to compartmentalize it. Like I said, that's bad Jay. There's going to be good Jay, and that was bad Jay. And I, you know, it had my little, you know, teddy bear therapy, and I was fine for the rest of the shoot. Fast forward, I'm now editing the film, and I'm doing a deep dive in archival footage. And Albert Mazels actually shot Jay for a very short piece. He actually did a week of filming, but he was one of the eight photographers. It was one of these, you know, short pieces that he did on a group of photographers, and Jay was one of them. So I found out about Albert shooting street stuff because I wanted to get street stuff of Jay. When I started filming him, he really wasn't shooting on the street anymore. And so I get the actual footage weeks left, and I have Albert sitting there, you know, talking to Jay, and he's setting up his camera, and like, okay, Jay, this looks good. Okay, you ready to start? Jay goes,
"Yes, Albert, I'm ready to start." He says, "I just want to tell you something. You're only as intelligent as the person interviewing you." And I go, "Oh my God, he told that to Albert Meisel." I said, "This is fantastic." I pick up the phone, I go, "Hey man, how you doing?" He goes, "Hey man, you sound happy." I said, "I am happy." I said, "Why are you happy?" I said, "Because I just found some footage. I felt so much better after I saw this footage because I realized you told one of the greatest, arguably the greatest documentarian of all time, that you're only as intelligent as the person interviewing you. I feel so much better now." So
I had two other questions.
Yes, really, sorry.
One, the other one was, where can we see the film elsewhere? And the last one was, what will he do with the things in storage? Does he ever share any of the items he has?
He's got everything back now.
Giving them away?
Oh yeah, he has given certain things away. I have to say, I received a basket that I've always wanted. It was a bread basket that's in one of the rooms. You'll see it. It was an old Sunbeam basket. It looks like an abstract sculpture, He's cherry picking certain things, but all 11 truckloads, he had to part with certain things. I think he did have to let go, but he gave them to people that, you know, stuff away that people he know will appreciate his objects, you know, his love for objects. As far as the film goes, we've just been extended actually at Film Forum in New York, and it's going to be playing here also, right?
Yeah, we're going to open it either on the 23rd or the 30th, so just look for web listings for it.
Yeah,
too.
And www.jmyself.com has, if you have friends in L.A., we're opening in L.A. August 16th, this next week, so just go to the website and you can share it's a small film, and you know the word of mouth is really important to us. So anything, spread the word. It's a film about love, and thank you.
All right, Bill, take us home. Last question.
Last question.
Visually an incredibly stunning film, but you mentioned one of the editors was a comedic editor, and I also thought, because of that, the pace was really great.
Yeah, thank you.
But also, I found the music incredible.
Yeah, thank you. Joel Goodman, who is my the guy who did all the orchestrations, is a genius. And one of the things for me was Jay was very into jazz, and whenever I got into the bank, I would always hear jazz. And Jay, you know, photographed all these great jazz musicians. So for me, I knew in the beginning of the film, as I was introducing you to the story, I really wanted the classic jazz tracks to sort of cut along with Joel's score. And I think they really kind of created a pace. But like I said, I had a fantastic team, you know, honestly, to be able to work with some of the people I worked with for your first film was a big deal. But I have to say, when we did the teaser, I had Emma, Tammy, and Henry Jacobson of Mindhive. They're my producers, and my wife, Betty. And even my daughter, Jenny, is involved with this. She helped me cut the teaser, which is, I can't tell you, I probably wouldn't have gotten any of these people interested if we didn't have a teaser like we had. But the truth is that people, when they fall in love with a story, and everybody has passion for a project, I think this is what can happen. And that's really what I was blessed with. I think people connected to the story, fell in love with Jay, fell in love with this idea of what the story I was trying to tell, and everybody got on the same page, and we all kind of, you know, we jumped on this train ride together, and that's, you know, that's the magical part of it. You just never know that's going to happen, but you can, I think, feel it, and I think that's been the greatest experience for me, is watching the film touch people, watching people come out of the film and say to me, you know what, I'll never see things the same way after seeing this film. You know, so that's the great joy.
Stephen, thanks so much for coming.
Stephen Wilkes, everybody.
It's a great pleasure. Thank you.